It's an honor being here. I have to tell you, when Luke called me and said, "Hey Matt, you know, I want you to come to this event in Canada and talk," I said, "Really? What, you know, what?" Well, it's this women and lead. I said, "I'm there." So, Luke always puts on amazing events, and this is, certainly is one of them. So, thank you all for sharing your night with us. So, this is my honor to introduce Margaret tonight. Margaret is a 20-year IT veteran, and has just done a tremendous number of things in the business. When you look at everything from cloud computing to open source to women in technology to speaking on the intersection of business and technology. She does serve as an advisor to Cloud Connect as well as the Cloud Network of Women. And also, she does advise several early stage startups as well as CEOs on strategy. And she's also a great mentor to both men and women in technology. And as a matter of fact, she was recently recognized with a Stevie Award as for her great work and mentorship. So congratulations to her for that. She's been an executive at HP, at Microsoft, as well as Amazon. And she currently works for Red Hat as the head of global product marketing, and is just doing great things for us. So we're very happy to have her here and speaking on her special ability when she laughs, which I'm sure you may be honored enough to catch a little bit of tonight. So without any further ado, Margaret.
This group is lets their light shine a little bit more than most groups that I talk to, but when I laugh, I snort. So if you're actually funny, I may snort, so we'll see. I'm actually on the backside of a cold as well, so I've been drinking wine, which Andre told me was the way to feel better when you're sick, which I was not aware of. I've heard of hot toddies, but so I actually do feel better. Like, my nose is kind of dried up right now, so it's all working. But this has been a journey, and it's a talk that I started about 4 years ago, when I spoke to a room of about 500 women executives in technology. And it's kind of evolved over the years, and I've done it to small groups like this and very large groups. And really, it's about my journey in figuring out how to really be true to myself while being a woman executive in tech. And we all want to believe that we are very much in tune with who we are at all times, but it's been interesting, and this is very interactive, so I'm gonna ask for you to contribute to some of this and give me feedback and let me know what you think and how we can continue. My goal at some point is to actually write a book and or do a TED talk on this, so the more I evolve it and learn how to improve it, the better. This is just a quote that I love, and I had this above my desk for many, many years, because so often we think that it's the negative part of us that we're scared of, and I'm just going to read this out loud, even though I'm pretty confident y'all can read it. Our greatest fear is not that we are inadequate, but that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light and not our darkness that frightens us. And if you don't know Marianne Williamson, she is a wonderful, just inspiring person. And what's funny is the first time I saw this quote, it was actually attributed to Nelson Mandela in his inauguration speech, which made perfect sense to me. And then as I started to research it more, it turns out it was actually Marianne that spoke it. And I thought, well, isn't that just typical that, a perfect, quote is actually given by a man? But the fact was, Nelson Mandela did make me feel so much better. But it was still kind of ironic. So, this is a question that I know over the lifetime, for myself, I've asked myself. So I'm just going to ask you, how many times and from throughout your life have you at some point said, why am I here? Who am I? What is my purpose? What am I doing? So I'm seeing nods. You don't have to raise your hand, but nods get it. So I find it interesting, and I used to think that this was a woman issue. And what's so interesting is that I have 5 children, 4 boys, and what I've learned in giving this talk, but also in just talking to so many people of every age, every background, is that this is actually a human issue. And that, you know, at some point we start questioning, you know, who am I? Why am I here? And so my hypothesis, or what we're going to talk about, is that the whole reason you are here is to be you. It's not just about any version of you. The reason you are here is not just to slack and just be whatever you show up some morning, but it is to be the best version of you. Right? And that every day, that best version is showing up. And we know that's a lot easier after you've had a couple glasses of wine. So I like to call that letting your true light shine. So what is this light? And it's funny that since I've started doing this, I've noticed that a lot of people, just kind of like popular culture, we're starting to talk about this light more, which I think is a very positive thing. Maybe it's about the, you know, politics in the US and so much darkness that has happened, or I don't know, some of the things that are happening around the world, but I think all of us are kind of seeking greater light or enlightenment. But really, at the end of the day, how I think about this light is what makes you you. It's that one thing that no one else has, right? And you're born with it. And I really do believe, I don't know how many of you are parents. You can see this in a baby the moment they are born, right? There is a light that is in every single person. And unfortunately, not everyone shines it, but there is something unique that is just you, that makes you you, that is truly frickin' beautiful, right? That is this light. It's also what I call the connection to the universe. It's what makes you feel like you have that special connection to other people, but also just to this place, you know, that we live in. And I like to compare it to, try to think back to your youngest memory. And usually it's around 3 or 4. We don't remember a whole lot before that. And we don't always remember a whole lot after that. But there's this sweet spot. Like for me, it was 4 years old. And I love this picture because I saw a picture of myself when I was about 4 and it kind of felt like this. When I was 4 years old, I wanted my name to be Candy. Because it wasn't because I wanted to be a stripper, although that's a fair assumption. It was because there was a show on television called Here Come the Brides with Bobby Sherman, who I love, so I'm aging myself. And his girlfriend was named Candy, and she had red hair, and I thought she was beautiful. And so I would just tell everyone my name was Candy. And it drove my mother insane, because people would say, what's your name? I'd say, Candy. And they'd say, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I said, a famous actress. And they said, well, can you act and sing? And I said, of course, you know. And I would go around constantly just singing about anything. And so if I was here right now, I'd be like, I'm in a conference room, and I'm talking, and we're having fun, drinking wine. Like, it didn't matter. I just sang about everything. It drove my parents absolutely mad. But I didn't care, right? Because when you're 4 years old, I mean, the world is just your universe, right? And you just assume everyone loves you and that you are great. You know, and you don't, no one is willing to really tell you otherwise at that point, hopefully, right? So think back to that moment, and think back to any moment that you can remember in your childhood when you just had no judgment against yourself, when you were just completely free to be you. And hold on to that for a moment. I like to call it before the input. And I've put examples here of my input that I received. Don't play with boys. So I already mentioned that I worked in Detroit. I grew up, my father was in the automotive industry. So I spent my childhood on racetracks. I had an awesome Hot Wheels set. I was very much a tomboy. I was tall and skinny and had long legs. And so girl clothes didn't fit me. So I wore boy clothes and I thought that was cool. And so I constantly was told things like, see, stop singing all the time. I told you I sang all the time. So somewhere after 4 years old, when I didn't have this judgment against myself, I started receiving this input. And I remember some of this very clearly at around 9 or 10. So does anyone remember first input that they started receiving?
I do.
Yes.
I was in Iran. I turned 12 and my bike was taken away from me.
Because, and what was the input? What were you told?
I started growing breasts, and I couldn't ride the bike anymore.
You know, there's nothing worse than when you fall over on your bike because your breasts are so heavy. I personally still ride a bike now. I don't have that problem. I think that's, I can totally understand.
on that.
Wait, now I've lost my spot. Where did they go? Out of my brain.
Wait. Go back. One more.
How did I lose? Wait.
Whoa.
Step two, step one. Wait.
There.
One more.
How do we keep going so far?
Oh my God.
Am I just like pushing this every time someone says something? Okay, that's a great one. So your input was, you now have breasts, you can't ride a bike.
It wasn't even a breast, but anyway.
It wasn't even a breast. Okay, so it was just your two, you can't ride a bike. Other input, I've never had that one. So that's, thank you.
You can use that.
That I will use that next time. I'm absolutely going to use that. Yes, ma'am.
My grade 5 report card said I was gregarious. And I didn't even know what that meant until I got home and got paid shit for it.
So her fifth grade report card said she was gregarious. And this was a negative.
Yes.
Interesting. Okay, so how dare you be gregarious? Okay, so what did that make you? So your parents said, stop being so gregarious. So that's a perfect example, right? Stop being yourself, stop being gregarious. Other input. Yes, ma'am.
I got my only C in fifth grade for being too imaginative in my fictional story writing.
Oh, so I love that. Okay, stop being so imaginative. How dare you with fiction? Stop being imaginative. No, so the input you're talking about is really important because it's not just what it does to your light or your ability to see yourself in a certain way, but where do you go academically? What do you think you're good at? All of this input starts to impact that. So we'd like to think as women in tech that we are so beyond this. Because we've actually been successful in a male-dominated, you know, environment that is very competitive. And yet, I will tell you, over my 20-plus years, as Matt said, in IT, the input has continued. And there's been times in my career where this has really, either caught me off guard or has caused me to stop fighting for what I think is right, or maybe not go for a promotion because I start to internalize the input. And some of this has happened both at work or personally as I've gotten older. Lowering my profile. This has been a really interesting one. As I started to become more successful, this was at a former company that I was at, where I was out speaking a lot, and I was told by my male boss that I needed to lower my profile because one of my peers was very intimidated and really felt that I was outshining everyone. Youth and innocence knows no color, knows no race, knows no religion, right? How do we go back to that age of innocence almost? I mean, that's really, it would be ideal, right, if we all looked at people with no filter. Anybody else want to share anything? Yes?
I don't know where mine falls in, but I'm thinking it's about I was 21 years old and I had just gone back to high school to get ready to go to university because I had dropped out. And I worked my ass off and I have a swearing problem and I snort. So this is actually really appealing to me. And I get told both of those things. And I remember working really, really hard and I decided to go to school and I'm going to date myself exactly. I was awarded a Canada scholarship by Kim Campbell. One of six in Canada, and my mother said to me, you're not going to accept that, are you? No one will ever want to be with a successful woman.
Oh! Ouch. Yeah. Oh, that one gives me chills. That's really good input. Yeah. And I actually know who Kim Campbell is. I'm American. Yeah. Okay, just for the record.
19 days.
Yes, I know. Right? Yeah. It's so sad. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Margaret. When I started out as a reporter years ago, one of the things that
And so what did you do? Did you go for a drink?
I ended up going for a drink, but I do agree with my dad. It was like, I would never get.
Yeah, we could probably spend a whole night about, you know, being one of the boys, not being one of the boys, and what that means. Howie?
So I finished high school. I was out working as a clerk in a bank.
why do you want to go back to school when you're going to end up in a kitchen?
It's interesting, and I think our parents do this with the absolute best intentions. I mean, the one I remember was when I was in sixth grade, and I had a choice of taking, I don't remember what it was, but it was like auto mechanic or typing. And my mom said, well, you have to take typing because then you can always fall back on being a secretary. And so I took typing, and what was funny is when I became a journalist and I got into tech and, you know, I was coding and different things, typing became really, really helpful, actually, you know, which was not what her thought was when I was learning how to type, but in hindsight, it was actually excellent. Anyway, so think about just, you know, as we go on. So what's happening with all this input, and you'll hear me say this, and you know, one of the things I will always tell people I'm mentoring is that input is just that, input. And when you hear people giving you wonderful advice, like all those things we've heard tonight, you can actually say with an absolute straight face, thank you for the input. Externally, you know, you're being very genuine, and it's true. Thank you for the input, and it's just that and nothing more. It is just input. Because what's happening is, over time, as we started, like that picture, you know, being true to who we were and our light was just shining from us, we slowly, slowly closed in the borders, came in this way, right? And over time, sometimes we even forget what that light is. And it's not that we don't know what we're good at. That's not what I'm saying, right? You all know what you're good at, obviously. But it's a deeper issue. It's that being true to really who you are and how that impacts yourself and everyone around you. And because we are hiding our light, I truly believe this is why we're seeing numbers go the opposite direction. Right? Numbers of women in tech are going down, not up. And what's interesting is the number of women graduating from college, graduating with even computer science degrees, graduating with MBAs and other high-level degrees, PhDs, etc. The number of women, or I should say young girls, interested in math and science in middle school, those numbers are all up significantly. But when it actually gets to women in tech, and then if you look at executive numbers in tech, it's gone from like 18 to 12% over the past 10 years. So what is happening? Why are those numbers going down when more and more of us are capable, interested? And it's also in spite of the fact that research again and again shows, and people that are in these companies, and you can talk to men who hire women, they will validate this, right? Boards that have women on that, women that have companies that have more women on them are more profitable, have a higher employee satisfaction. So there's a lot of evidence to show that just diversity, I mean, I could take it beyond women, just companies that are diverse are more successful. Why? Because they're actually representing their customer base, most likely, right? So here's the first issue, and I keep thinking this was going to change, because I saw this in the generation just before me. But the women that do make it are not empowering others. And I don't know if any of you have experienced this. I've experienced this firsthand, and it always perplexes me, because, you know, the naive optimism I have is that, you know, if one of us have made it, don't we want everyone to make it? But for some reason, we've had the antithesis happen, where women that have actually made it are so afraid that someone's going to knock them down that they're not encouraging other women. And a lot of you are nodding your head, so I'm, you know, assuming you've seen this. I had an experience not that long ago where I was literally bullied by another woman at work, which I have not been bullied since I was about 10 years old. And it actually shocked me. Like, I didn't actually realize what was happening when it happened, you know? And then I realized, and I called her and I said, you're bullying me. Like, you're being a bully. Like, what the hell, you know? And she knew it. And it was just so shocking to me. And she's like, yeah, well, you need to stop doing that. And I was just totally taken aback. So it's even some women are not even ashamed of the fact that, like, it's even, they know they're doing it. You know, it's like, she's like, get out of my swim lane. And I was like, wow. So two things that I hadn't had happen to me since I was like well, 12, because that was when I was on a swim team, and someone used the word swim lane, which I also had not heard. So, I mean, we have this behavior that somehow we think is okay against other women, which I just, you know, I don't think it's okay. This is one of my favorite questions. How many times have you seen another woman not embrace or even be negative about another woman's life? Having so many boys, I remember when they were very small thinking, how do I raise good men? You know, not just to be good people, but to want to be with a woman who is strong. Like the best, to me, the best compliment that one of my sons can give me is to, you know, bring home a woman who is confident and successful and knows herself and is letting her light shine, right? And he's in love with her, right? So, you know, every time when they were in high school and they'd bring home, you know, like some dumb cheerleader, I'd be like, yeah. They're very smart cheerleaders. They're, that's my own bag. I know, I do. Probably you were cheerleaders. I know. It's my own baggage. It's not about you. Anyway, but my point is that, you know, it's not just about us, it's about the next generation. And if we are going to change this paradigm, right, we have to start doing things differently. So I've put together these steps that I literally have gone through, and these are not linear, even though I'm going to number them, but they're very cyclical. Like sometimes I have to go back to one of these steps because I've totally forgotten, you know, how to do something. But I love this first one called Get Grounded. And I will be completely transparent. I actually learned this one in marriage counseling, which anyone that's been married for a long time, if you haven't had to go to marriage counseling, I applaud you and get down and like bow down to you. Because marriage is the hardest thing in the entire world. And so we read this wonderful book called Intimacy and Desire by Dr. David Snarch, which has all kinds of good sex bits in it too, if you're interested. But Dr. Snarch and his wife, and she did not take his name, which I find very interesting. So she's not Mrs. Dr. Snarch. Anyway, Dr. Snarch calls this differentiation. And this is about that you are grounded in who you are. So that as you're getting all this input, you know, or as you're in this marital dispute, you don't lose a sense of who you are. Because so often what happens, and women, I will tell you, are worse at this than men, we lose ourselves in a relationship, right? So we will do anything to make the other person happy, even if it puts our happiness, you know, at risk. And so being differentiated means you are completely grounded in who you are so that you don't lose yourself in other relationships. But think about that with work or any relationship, parenting, your best girlfriend. Really, you can think about this in any context, that being differentiated means that you know yourself, you stay true to yourself, you stay grounded, and don't lose yourself no matter what's happening around you or what that other person's issues are. Because their happiness is not your job, right? Your happiness is your job. So the first thing you've got to do is just get true to who you are, get that grounded, that differentiation, right? And stop looking for the validation from others. And this is another thing. This was probably my biggest learning, and I probably still struggle with this all the time. And you know, it's waiting to be told that you're smart or you look good or you're successful or you're whatever from other people, instead of just feeling it in yourself. Like, I just feel good. I don't care if I'm, you know, not the prettiest girl or I'm not the smartest person or I'm not the richest person. Like, I feel good about myself, as opposed to waiting for someone else to tell you that. Right? And I think this is a huge issue. And to be differentiated, you've got to quit looking for it on the outside and you've got to feel it on the inside. And I've kind of aligned this, you know, with some work I've been doing around core values. And I find this really helpful. And if you ever have, you know, a key decision to make in your life, I've done a lot of work recently on kind of identifying, okay, what are my core values? And I love this quote by Gandhi, which is, your beliefs become your thoughts become your words become your actions become your habits become your values, and your values become your destiny. And there's no right or wrong or what your values are, right? They're yours, and you don't have to share them. And I just put down some that are mine. You know, family, empathy. I used to think that my empathy was a negative thing because I was so empathetic that it made me hurt inside, like when something happened to someone else, right? And then over time I realized that's actually a strength, you know, as long as it doesn't like overcome you. honesty. I would probably, in work, I always say I have this ethical bar where I just hate like doing things that are wrong. But constant growth, like that's a value. It's interesting, like I always want to feel like I'm changing and growing, being challenged, nurturing. Like I'm a parent, I'm a mother, I'm a manager. And I think being a manager made me a better parent. I think being a parent made me a better manager. Making an impact, that's really important to me. Like I want to leave the world having done something, you know, or left this, you know, my job doing something. So these are just examples, they're not right or wrong. You know, and the words don't matter, but just take time to kind of step back and say, you know, what are my core values? Which is what's important to you inside that makes you you. And I think the important thing is that, you know, and it doesn't matter if it makes you different. And I think that's part of it, is being willing to be different. Being willing to say that my values are different from your values, and that's okay. That's the point, right, is that we don't have all the same. And as I mentioned before, take that input just as input. So getting grounded, getting differentiated, identifying your core values, writing them down, even sharing them. I found just sharing those with my kids and my husband was really interesting. You know, and having them ask questions like, why did you put this as a core value? If you have kids that are especially teenagers or early 20s, ask them what their core values are. They won't know what it means, first of all, if they're teenagers, but it's a really important thing for them to think about, like, what are your core values as you're starting to become an adult? And I'm just going to let you read this. Music is really important to me. I grew up doing a lot of musical theater, but I find that, you know, some people can listen to music and it doesn't affect them. Like, when I watch a movie or read a book or listen to music, it's like I actually become that scene. So I have to be careful because I, like, forget that it's fictional or whatever. But I love this because it, just talking about, you know, I feel lovely just the way I am. You know, what gives you the right to tell me who I should be? And that's really something to think about when people are telling you what you should be like, giving you that input. You know, think about that. Like, they do not have the right to do that. You're the only person that has the right to do that for yourself. So you've gotten grounded, you're differentiated, you are a solid self, you know your core values. And now you are ready to find your light. So for me, when I realized my light was kind of diminished, I'm sure it had something to do with going through premenopause as well, which I don't know if any of you have gone through that, but it's really hard to get your light completely diminished during that time. Mostly because you're sweating so much, you can't even turn the light on. Anyway, one of it is going back to those things when you were a kid, right, when you had this like, oh, I just love myself, I'm so wonderful. What were you doing? Were there things that you used to do that you just stopped? We all have these things. Like, how many times have you heard someone say, I haven't played the clarinet for 20 years, right? Or I haven't sang, or I used to love swimming. I used to love skiing. I used to love, like, we do this all the time, right? Why did we stop doing it? I have no idea. So do one of those things. Like, I used to horseback ride all the time when I was 11, 12, 13, 14, you know, kind of in that core prepubescent period. I love horses. You know, I collected horses, you know, all those things that you do when you love horses. I probably had horses on my shirts or whatever. And so I had a girlfriend who trains horses, and I called her up and I said, hey, I want to learn how to ride a horse again. I haven't been on a horse for 35 years. I'm sure it'll be no big deal, just like riding a bike. So I want to do that. She said, okay, well, first we're going to just work in the circle. You don't get to ride a horse until you've had a relationship with a horse. So for 6 weeks, I was not allowed, I just met with her on Saturday mornings. I was not allowed to ride the horse. We just worked together, and I had to learn how to use the whip and have him follow me. And then after 6 weeks, she said, okay, he's following you, he's listening to you, you've bonded with him, you have control of the horse, I want you to connect with the horse. So next time you take him around the circle, then I want you to walk into the center of the ring, click at him, and when he comes to you, connect with him. So I go to the center of the ring, I click, you know, the horse comes, we meet here, and our heads go down, and literally we just stood like this for like 5 minutes. Tears just dropped down my face. Has anyone ever connected with a horse before? Like, do you ride? Oh my Lord. So I have no idea what happened in that ring, but I found my light in that moment, because through that horse. I mean, that horse knows his light. He's differentiated. I'll get out. But I did not deserve to get his light until that moment, right? And so think about that, too. It's like, you know, everyone doesn't necessarily deserve to get the full light of you, but, you know, how you connect with people and how you go back to things that you love doing. I also highly, highly recommend very, very fast cars, if that's something you need. So I had a midlife crisis, which was I just went and bought a convertible Mustang. I'm sorry, man, I'm kind of dissing you. It's so hard. It's just so easy. Like, you know, stereotypes are stereotypes for a reason. Anyway, but I do love fast cars, I mentioned. So I bought a convertible Mustang. And my children were not allowed to touch it or ride in it ever. And it works. It's really fun. So yours may not be a car, but think of your equivalent of a car. Maybe a diamond ring. It may be, I have no idea. Everyone's different. So that was mine. Ask the universe for help. As you're starting to look for your light, and if you're religious, this could be asking God for help, asking the universe for help. But honestly, we so rarely ask for help. And as you're looking for your light, just stepping back, it may be asking your mother, right? Or asking someone who knows you really well. Like, what do you think my light is? Right? But asking for help and exploring the options. And one thing I will tell you is that if you are truly asking for help, you will get an answer. And it is incredibly powerful. Has anyone ever experienced this? Yeah. And sometimes it's overwhelming. And someone mentioned risk before. And the thing I've seen with so many people, it's not just women, I would say so many people, is that one, we don't ask for help. Or when we do, we're not listening when the answer comes. And then if we do listen, we're not willing to actually do, you know, what it's telling us to do. So it's not just the asking, that's hard enough, but it's actually then taking the risk to say, you know what, that's right, I'm going to do that. Because that's scary. It's hard. But the first step is asking for help and just exploring those options that are presented to you. And it's funny because throughout my career, there's one comment that I've had multiple times, and that has been, you're so lucky, Margaret, you have options. And my answer is always, I have options because I've seen them and because I chose to act on them, but you have options. But very few people think they have options. You always have options. It's whether you're willing to explore them and take them. And this one is vital. Surround yourself with supportive people. I don't know why we put people around us that are not supportive. And sometimes that means making hard decisions about relationships. I have a very dysfunctional relationship with my mother, and I've become very honest about it because I've realized that I just need to not spend too much time with her, which is painful because she's my mother. But she's very toxic. And it's not her fault. She's not willing to go to therapy. So I just need to minimize my time around her. And that's okay. I love her. She is my mother. I will take care of her. But I know that I can only take her in small doses. Because otherwise, my light starts doing this real, real fast. Right? And so who are those people that you keep spending time with, even though you know what they're doing to you? You have a choice with that, even though it may sound painful. And filtering out that negative input. So every time you're with someone that says, you can't do that, why do you think you can do that? What makes you think all those words or phrases that start with that kind of thing, just filter that out. It's just input. So if you were right now going to try to identify it, would you say you know your light? But our whole reason that we are here, and this goes back to women in tech and everything else, is helping others find theirs, right? Being a model, being a beacon, to use a really bad analogy. And everyone's light is different and unique. And this is the hard thing, is that when you're going through this process, or when you're successful as a woman in tech, you think that your model is the model that works. Right? It takes a while to realize, and I'm sure you've all experienced this, like even when you're managing people, and you're giving someone a task to do something, and they do it in a totally different way, your first reaction is like, well, that's all wrong. Like, that's not the way you do it, right? But it's the way they do it. And this has been a constant learning for me. It's like how they get to that destination doesn't matter, right? Are you getting the result you want, and are you allowing them to discover how they do it? And so the same thing goes for light. So don't be the person giving the input. Just like you don't want to get that input, catch yourself when you're giving the input. And I catch myself doing this all the time, especially as a parent, but even as a manager, as a friend, you'll be like, oh, you know, I really, and then you're like, no, wait, am I giving input? Right? Catch yourself. Intentionally support other women. I love that quote that we just said. I was giving a talk once at CenturyLink to a group of women there, and it was more just an informal conversation. And they were kind of jazzed up at the end of the talk, and they're like, okay, what do we do with this? Like, is there an action we can take? And I said, okay, how about if, you know, every time you guys pass each other in the hallway for the next week, you just high-five each other? And they're like, well, that's silly. Why would we do that? Like, they were just like, why would we high-five each other? Like, because it's an intentional, like, just something so radical to remind each other that you have to intentionally recognize and support. Because half these women, they would like pass each other in the hallway and not even like, you know, say hi or anything. And so they did this. So for an entire week, every time they'd pass each other in the CenturyLink office, they'd be like, hey, hey, high five. And they'd be quite, pretty soon the men are all like, what's going on? Where are you guys? And so
they start high five.
The men started high five. So pretty soon everybody in the CenturyLink office in Bellevue, Washington starts going, hey, how's it going? Right? And so it became this like, and so I got all these emails from these women going, you're not going to believe this, the men are all high-fiving. They thought we had like some secret club, you know, stuff like that. But it was great, right? Because it actually, and they actually knew each other, and all of a sudden these women who worked together all the time went out for a drink together, started talking, found out what their jobs were, and they had never connected before, right? So I always say, you know, I get asked like, well, you can't really intentionally do that. You're not supposed to do that. I'm like, why? But somehow we're supposed, you know, we're supposed to feel bad for that. Like, well, you're not supposed to like intentionally support other women. Like, that's being the reverse of sexism. Okay. I'm going to intentionally support other women. So if you see a woman, especially if you see a woman, you know, that looks out of sorts, but even if she does, it's like, hey, I don't know you. You want to go for a drink?
Sure.
You know, what's the worst that can happen? She says no. Mentor, coach, and train. And this is not just women. This is just people, right? Be that beacon. You know, help people find their light. Help people discover the best version of themselves. And by the way, mentoring can be at any stage. I always tell people, like, I have mentors that are this one woman who is 25 years old, and she's my mentor. And she taught me how to do social media. She's scary smart. You know, everybody brings a different talent. We have this like hang up that mentors are always supposed to be, you know, older and wiser or something like that, but that's not really true. You know, and the more mentors you have, male, female, all different ages from all different parts of life, you know, kind of the better you become, because they're bringing perspectives you would never have. So think about that, because a lot of times people new to their careers will say, well, I can't be a mentor. Like, I need a mentor. That's not true. You absolutely can be a mentor. Hire and promote women. This kind of goes with that intentional. I love what Luke said in the beginning where he said, well, we didn't have enough women to do that, so we fixed that. Yes. Now, I'm not saying he went out specifically and, you know, found women. Maybe he did. I don't know. I mean, he could have. But this is not a bad thing, and this is another thing where people just say, well, you can't actually, you know, do that on purpose, but what you can do is that, you know, make a point of letting women know you're hiring. Or I will tell you, on my team, you know, I'm always asking the women on my team, do you want to be a people manager? What is your career growth? Okay, let's make you a people manager. Let's figure that out. Let's get you trained. Let's, you know, like, if they don't want to, fine, but, you know, you have to look and intentionally look at how do we help women be more successful? How do we bring them in? How do we get more women in tech? Because that's the only way it's going to change, right? So question, you can answer this one. It's not about you. How many of you know other women who are hiding their light? So if you think about other women that you work with or know. Okay, I'm just gonna, you guys are head nodders, not hand raisers, okay? Does Canada have like a traumatic experience? Like if you raise your hand, you get smacked or something. So. And then finally, in addition to helping others find their light, it's about shining your light on others. Because the thing that is important is that true light is positive. It's not ego. And this is really important, because some people think, well, I'm really good at this, and that's my light, right? But if you're shining ego, that's not actually light. That's just pure, icky ego, right? And so true light is always positive. It's always best intent. And it's not just about you. If you are shining your true light, you're actually making the world a better place. And that's the point. Yes, you become a better person. You will probably be more successful because it's just a natural thing that happens. But you're actually leaving the world a better place as well. And I have no idea what happened to this picture.
Whoa. Whoa.
So this is what happens when you go from a Linux machine to a Mac.
It's Minecraft.
But it's Minecraft. Yeah, that works. What this was a picture of one of my sons who was in musical theater, and I use this because this particular son, he's our youngest, and he would follow his brother just above him through everything when he was young. So his brother, just older than him, is the jock. So he did sports, he did baseball and basketball and blah, blah, blah. And so this younger brother just did all that stuff. And it was painful watching it because he was not really a great athlete. And I lived through many horrible basketball games and soccer games and things where I was like, honey, I think that, you know, maybe you could look at theater or music or dance or so many other things. Nope, I'm going to play baseball, Mom. Okay, awesome. You know, and so finally when he was like 11 or 12 years old, I said, hey, there's this really cool musical theater camp at the theater in town. What do you think about, you know, just doing that for a week, just check it out? He's like, yeah, okay. And I'm like, okay. Never looked back. I mean, just theater took over his life, which I, you know, you can see as a parent, but you can't push him. Like, they've got to find it, right? But he found it, and it was just so exciting watching him find that light, you know, where he just, you know, kind of found himself and realized that, you know, theater, and now he's directed shows, and he's done all this, and all this kind of stuff. But my point is that, you know, you finding your light and taking risk and doing things maybe that's different and helping others find theirs will have a direct impact on your children, right? And you'll be encouraging them to try new things, even if they're not what their brother is doing or their friends are doing. And that's very scary as a child, right? Because being different is very scary. And this is one that, and I'm gonna tell a story about this one, because I put, you know, helping your children find their light, but also being nice to that different girl. And this goes back to, I don't know how many of you were that different girl. I was that different girl in school. And I think that anyone that has experienced that, like the people that were nice to you, if you weren't like the popular girl or the, you know, whatever it was, think about that in your work or your day. What was so interesting is I did this talk actually at Red Hat, and everybody brought their daughters to our offices outside of Westford. And there was a 9-year-old girl that came with her dad, and I went up to her afterwards and I said, you know, what'd you think of the talk? And this little girl is way, she's got like, you know those kids you meet with the old soul? She has an old soul. And she's like, well, I found it very interesting, and I think we're going to go home and talk about it. And I said, okay. And I said, well, and I said, you know, did anything that I say stand out to you? She's like, well, yeah. And I said, you know, do you know any girls that, you know, are hiding their light? And she's like, well, we had this experience recently where a girl, you know, was talking to a group of girls, there's a group of us, and she said that she was anxious to go home and play with her doll. And the other girls, and these are 9-year-olds, the other girls immediately just made fun of her and said, what are you, a baby? You're 9 years old. You don't play with dolls anymore. What's wrong with you? You're blah, blah, blah. You know, and they just, all the other girls attacked this girl. What happened over the next few days, she said, is that girl stopped talking. She stopped hanging out with those girls at recess. She started, you know, hanging out by herself. She started, like, not going out on recess. And I said, interesting. I said, so what are you going to do? And she's like, well, I'm thinking about this. She's like, clearly that's just something she likes to do. It's not right or wrong. And she goes, so I'm going to go up to her at school tomorrow and say, why don't we go to her house and play with dolls? And I said, okay, well, you'll have to let it. Just gives me chills, too, because this little girl was like, she was so, you know, intense, but so genuine in it. Like, she really bothered her. Like, after hearing this, it hadn't, I don't think she realized how bad it was. And all of a sudden, this, like, impacted her. Like, oh, my God, we just, like, took that little girl and went, yeah. you know, which who knows why she plays with dolls. Maybe she has an amazing imagination and that's the way she does, you know, scenes of, you know, movies, or who knows, right? But they didn't take the time to know. All they told her was, you know, that was wrong. And so, you know, this really impacted her. And really start now. So it's hard work, but like I said, you know, this is cyclical. Like, you may feel like you're doing really well and you're shining your light, and then you have a dark day. And I say, as you're doing this and throughout life, as we continue to always improve ourselves and always become a better person, you've got to allow yourself to have dark days. And you know, I was at the airport for 8 hours yesterday. I wasn't really shining my light much by the time I got on the plane. The flight attendant was definitely not shining her light by the time we got on the plane. We get on, she's like, okay, we're really going this time. Everybody knows the drill. Let's go. And know your hot buttons. And this is really important, like the grocery store. So if I do have to go to Costco, my husband pushes the cart. I roam free, so I can just go get what I need, throw in the cart, and then, you know, just move so I don't hurt anybody, because that's my hot button. Because if I'm pushing the cart and I get stuck by those people that are around the food items all, you know, trying to, you know, especially if you go at feeding time, like at 6 o'clock. So know your hot buttons. What are your hot buttons? You know, and avoid those, because if you know that's going to be the time, you can't let your light shine. You're going to have that dark moment. Just avoid that as much as you can, or prepare for it, you know, with mini Zen breaths and, you know, whatever is your thing. And most importantly, be nice to yourself. If you leave with nothing tonight other than this, because I don't know what it is about humans, but especially women, we are our own worst enemy, right? So just, you know, treat yourself with absolute compassion. And this is hard. I mean, it's really hard. Like, I felt like crap today. I have a cold, and I was just like, I'm going to suck. I don't want to go do this. I just want to stay in the bathtub. You know, and you can psych yourself out of a lot of things just with your own voice. So don't listen to that negative voice in your head. You know, change it out with a very nice story. And I'm just gonna end with this. I won't say it, but if you don't know Pink, I love this song, which I didn't even know these were the real words until I got it on my iPod, because I'd only heard it on the radio. And it was the, you know, the cleaned up version, but the real version is even better. Like, when you're working out, this is a great song to work out to. And sometimes that means you've gotta make a change. So this is risk. You made a huge change to find your light. Jumped off the corporate ladder. I don't mean to be picking on you, but it's exciting. That's very hard to do, right? I keep saying, oh, I'm gonna write a book, oh, I'm gonna go on a speaking tour. Like, have I done it yet? No. So I can sit up here and tell you all this great stuff, but, you know, am I willing to totally jump off that cliff and do it? And this is something that you really need to think about as you're going through this process and you're being nice to yourself and you're finding your light, you're helping others. Oftentimes, it involves forgiveness. It may be forgiving yourself, it may be forgiving someone else. But the ability to forgive is critical. And this is a very new learning for me, like literally last 6 months learning. I didn't know forgiveness was part of this process, but it really is. And so, you know, as we go forward, and sometimes you'll have to go back to this, you'll feel like everything's going great and something will happen, and you'll realize you're stuck, and it may just be you have to just forgive something and let it go. And letting things go is really hard. And forgiveness is really hard, especially when it's forgiving yourself. And even if others don't forgive you, don't let that stop you, right? Forgiving yourself is most important, because that's them. You can't change them, right? You can only change yourself. But at the end of the day, we're here once, and we should be just living this absolute fully. So when you leave here tonight, and when you see each other in the future, you know, do a check on each other, high five, whatever it is. But what's funny is I actually, you know, when I see women that have heard me give this talk before, like, sometimes I'm like, Margaret, I'm letting my light shine. You know, and I'm just like, okay. This woman came up to me in the airport one time. It was like this random Minneapolis airport. She's like, oh my God, Margaret Dawson. And I said, yes. Like, I didn't know if I was being served. I didn't know what was going on. She's like, I'm letting my light shine. And I'm like, okay. And we're like on those moving sidewalks. And of course, everyone around is like, what? But they probably kept that with them. They're like, that girl's letting her light shine. Anyway, hope that was helpful. I'm leaving you with Shine by Anna Nalick. If you don't know the song, it is an awesome song. Like I said, we can talk about this more, but I hope this was fun, interesting, and left you with something to think about.